Tuned us in, and I'm glad you're here with us today. To let everyone know, you know, our services are open. You're willing to come. We hope to have you. But you know, while you're at home and you still feel like it, we're still doing our services online. I hope you tune in, and I hope you listen to the whole sermon and all the music, the whole service. And remember to tune in to 101.9 FM at 8 a.m. on Sundays. We can also hear the message and hear the music of our church every Sunday morning. But right now, we're going to prepare our hearts for communion. Right now, we are going to come to the table and remember the sacrifice that Jesus Christ did 2,000 years ago. If you'd open up your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 17. But the Lord stood with me and strengthened me so that the message might be preached fully through me and that all the Gentiles might hear. Also, I have delivered out of the mouth of the lion, and the Lord will deliver me from every evil works and preserve me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. You know, the Lord strengthens us at this table by us remembering what Jesus Christ did on that cross 2,000 years ago. His body was beaten. His body was broken because of our sins. His blood was also shed, so that we can become children of God in the new covenant. So while on that night, just before he was betrayed, he was sitting around the table and he took a piece of bread. And he says, "This is my body that was broken for you." And I hope every one of you have a piece of bread right now or a cracker that you could use, because it symbolizes his broken body. And so we need to break the bread like he did, so that we remember of what the sacrifice was. And once we break the bread and we give thanks, we participate and we eat and we remember what Jesus Christ did 2,000 years ago. On the same night that he was betrayed, he also picked up the cup and says, "This is my blood that was shed for many. This is the new covenant. We've taken, and we remember his broken body, but right now we take of the cup of the blood that cleanses us and washes away every sin that we have." So church, I hope you have some juice and I hope you're ready, because this is important. Because through this sacrifice, we're no longer under the old covenant, but we're under the new covenant. And we are now children of God. And church, before we partake, let us bow our heads in prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, I thank you. I praise you. I thank you for the broken body. Lord, I thank you for this cup. And I thank you that you strengthen us, Lord, that we may accomplish what you have called us to do. But right now at this table, Lord, forgive me for all my sins. Forgive me, Lord, for my failures and where I have come short. Lord, I do remember your sacrifice. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Church, let us partake together. I hope you all partook with us. I hope you all came and remembered Jesus Christ. But stay tuned. We got some great music and we got a sermon coming. How can we be a witness to the second coming of Jesus Christ? So stay tuned. Don't go away. If you have to, go get a cup of coffee real quick. But the music starts now. God bless, and so glad you're here. thank you very much for participating with us.
You are.
I hope you enjoyed the music. I hope you raised your voices and praised God. Now, let's open up our ears and hear what the Lord has for us. And today, I'd like to talk about how can we be a witness to the second coming of Jesus Christ. It's very important that we remember that we're here to be a witness for others so that they may understand that one day, the Jesus that died on the cross, the Jesus that rose from the grave, the Jesus that ascended into heaven, will one day come back. How can we be part of that message? How can we be part to show the world the expectation of Jesus Christ returning? I've taken a lot of this message from an article that Josh Laxton wrote, and he took it and he kind of condensed a little study that he had on John the Baptist. And his title was, "We Can Become a Prophetic Witness in the Second Coming." And he's talking about how John the Baptist could help us to understand how we can be the prophet or prophesy or work towards letting the world know that we are waiting for the King to return. We live in an interesting cultural moment right now. Our culture is so divided. We've got so many different things going on. We've got pagan religions popping up everywhere. We've got things on television. But I tell you one thing that has not changed, and that's the attack on the church. The attack is attacking. The devil is trying to destroy us and divide us. But you know, we're united because of the Word of God. We're united because of the Holy Spirit. But the cultural movement today is so different than it was for our grandfathers, our fathers. The church, which once seemed to hold such a prominence in America, now finds itself increasingly on the margins. We're not called in. Even the COVID-19, I watch and listen, I see all of these panels. There's not a single pastor on those panels. The pastors are not there because the culture has changed. It used to be where the church was so important in the community. Today, it's kind of put on the sidelines. So we need to still focus on what our mission is. Go into all the world. And that means across the street. That means to your coworker. That also means to other countries. This trend can scare some people about what's happening in the church. But we must find winsome and creative ways. We must be creative in how to engage into this culture for the sake of the people around us. See, we're not engaging into the culture for our sake. We're doing it so that they can hear and listen to the Word of God. For faith comes by hearing and hearing of the Word of God. And if we proclaim the gospel, as the Bible says, for my word will not come back void. So therefore, but we need to be in that culture. We need to be in that place. And we need to be a church that's reaching out to those that are lost. Thinking about the cultural engagement, however, isn't something it's not something new. It's not something that just happens in this culture today. This has happened throughout history. The church has always had to reach out and touch that culture that was so anti-church. The culture is so much, they move so much against the church. I can tell you about creation, that God created the world. He spoke it into the world, and all of a sudden that's a problem. But I can watch a TV show on History Channel, Ancient Aliens, and say that spaceships came. I saw one the other day on Elijah. You know, Elijah was favored by God, and he went up in this firing chariot. Well, Ancient Aliens says it wasn't a fiery chariot. It was a spaceship. But no one ever has a problem with that. But if a pastor gets up there and says, God delivered them, well, then we have a problem. That's the culture we're in. But that culture has been affecting the church ever since Jesus Christ came and was born and walked the earth. How can we help our churches think about our engagement as aliens and sojourners in a pagan and post-Christian land? How can our church, not just this church, all of our churches in America, across denominations, how can we think about engaging into a culture that we are aliens to? When the church performs this prophetic duty to reflect the King in all realms of life, in every aspect of life, the church becomes the most effective church in the world. When we engage in prophetic duty of telling people about the second coming, about teaching people that Christ is going to return. And we do it in an effective way in every realm, in every aspect of life. We can become world changers. Here are four observations on how John the Baptist was a prophetic witness to the first coming of Christ, and how the church too can be a prophetic witness to the second coming of Christ. Now let's look at John, what he did, and let's look at what we can do. By prophetic witness, I mean believers who seek to embody and evangelize the truth that the King has come. The King is coming again to make all things new. This is going to happen. But how can we prophesy that coming? How can we be that church? Well, let's look at the first one. We must preserve a prophetic existence. John the Baptist lived in the desert, wore unfashionable clothes. Anybody know what clothes he wore? And he had a very unusual diet. Now, how many of you would love to dress in camel, sheep, and walk around in the desert and eat locusts with honey? Wouldn't that be a great prophecy? People think we're crazy, but John the Baptist did that. But interesting, he didn't have to do any of those things. He had the resources. He did it because he had a purpose, and he went out of his way to be different than the rest of the world. He did so out of the prophetic existence of what he was doing. As a result of his prophetic resistance pointed to the future deliverance. And what he did was to point and prepare the road for the Lord. He did it so that he would be different. His prophetic style and diet pointed to living a simple life. Did you know that the first two disciples that Jesus called, Simon and his brother, they were both disciples of John the Baptist? Anthony was a disciple. Simon Peter, later called Peter, was a disciple of John the Baptist. See, John was preparing their hearts. When Jesus came, they immediately recognized Jesus because of how and what John the Baptist was preaching. As believers, our prophetic existence necessitates us remembering that the world is not our permanent home, and that we are looking towards a home yet to come. It's very important that we understand that this is not our home. If you open up your Bibles to Hebrews 13, verse 14. Hebrews 13, verse 14. Here we have no continuing city or no lasting city, but we seek the one to come. It says right here, the writers of Hebrews says, for here we have no city, lasting city, where this is not where we're supposed to be, but we seek the one to come. It's the New Jerusalem. Therefore, by him, let us continuously offer the sacrifice of praise to God. I hope you're praising God this morning. I hope you raise your voice. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks in his name. But do not forget to do good and to share, for which such sacrifice God is well pleased. We know that we're sojourners here, that we know that this is not our permanent home. Therefore, we live in the here and now as ambassadors. Ambassadors means we have authority. An ambassador of the United States and other countries have authority. They have authority, they represent the President of the United States. We are representative of Jesus Christ on this planet. We are to take the gospel of Jesus Christ. And how do I know we're ambassadors? Well, 2 Corinthians 5:20 tells us so. We're strangers and exiles, 1 Peter 2:11 and 12, in a foreign land. Can you imagine you born in America, you're considered in a foreign land? Because when you accepted Jesus Christ, your citizenship was transferred from being an American to being in the kingdom of God. We are here so that Americans could hear the gospel, and we're sent as ambassadors into the world. Are we doing that today? Is our lifestyle, does it point to the coming of this new world or new world order? Now, the devil loves a new world order, but it's not the order that God established. There's going to be a time when that trumpet's going to sound and Jesus is going to show up in the eastern skies. And all of us that are alive when that happens, in a twinkle of an eye, will be up there with him in heaven. Wouldn't that be a great thing? But wouldn't it also be a sad time if we have not done what we're supposed to do as ambassadors? Can you imagine an ambassador in a foreign country that does not give and talk and explain to the country that they're in the intent of the President of the United States? He'd be fired. They would remove him as an ambassador. We need to have a lifestyle that points. That's what John the Baptist was doing. He lived a lifestyle that would point into preparing the way for Jesus Christ. When this world doesn't look or feel like home, when this world doesn't look or feel like home, because we're being attacked, because we're being put down, because being a Christian is hard, or because I can't do what I like to do, or people start attacking us because of what we believe in and because of what we do. Here's the hardest thing about this. We don't attack back. We don't criticize. We don't degenerate or retaliate. Man, that is the hardest thing for me. 20 years in the military, when somebody attacks me, I immediately want to retaliate. I immediately want to criticize. Oh, man. Isn't it great to criticize governments? Isn't it great to criticize leaders? But I wonder if we ever looked in the mirror ourselves. When this world doesn't feel like our home, it doesn't feel like us, we should never turn into their tactics. We should never use their tactics. And when we do, we hurt the prophetic message of the church. And when we do, we hurt others. But there's good news. We can repent. But what about the damage that we have done? We love to pray, intercede for the world, all the while exclaiming, Maranatha. Everybody know what Maranatha means? Have you ever read that? It's in 1 Corinthians 16 in verse 22. Now, it's not in the New King James, but it is in the King James. It says, if anyone does not love the Lord Christ, let him be accursed. Maranatha. Let him be accursed. If anyone does not love the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be accursed. It didn't say for you to curse them. It says, let them be accursed. But Maranatha is a very important word here. It consists of two Armenian words, Maran and Atha, meaning our Lord comes or is coming. If anyone does not love the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be accursed. Oh, Lord, come, or the Lord is coming. Because, you see, we're talking about a future event. We are prophesying. We are telling people about Jesus. It is their call. Message last week. It is not our job to determine where the seeds land. It is our job to plant the seeds. And it's the individual's choice to accept or deny. If anyone does not love the Lord, let him be accursed. For the Lord is coming. If the latter interpretation is adopted as a meaning of this phrase, our Lord is coming, and he will judge those who have set him not, who have said nothing, have accepted nothing that was taught. James 5:8-9, you also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, brethren, lest you be condemned. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. What is James saying? You also be patient. We also need to understand when the world attacks us, we need to be a very patient people. And most of you that know me, that's a hard thing for me to be patient about anything. I want it now. I want to do it now. Why are we delaying? I'm frustrated right now in getting food to our churches in South America because of the red tape that I'm having to go through. I'm losing my patience. I almost feel like I'll just get a boat and go there myself. But it says, you also be patient. Establish your heart, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. It is in God's hands. I'm willing. We need to be willing. But sometimes we just need to wait on the Lord. The second thing is we need to proclaim the prophetic message. There's a message here. John the Baptist had a very simple message. Repent, because the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Because he was out there, and we read that in Matthew 3, 1 through 2. But he's telling us very simple. It's very clear. Repent, because the kingdom of heaven is coming. Because Jesus Christ is coming. He is preparing the road for Jesus Christ. The major difference between his prophetic message of repentance and ours is that it falls, his falls before Jesus' ministry. His falls before his death. His ministry came before his resurrection. Today, the church has the same message with a little bit more precision, though. We do it with power and authority given to us by Christ's death, by his resurrection, and his ascension. So therefore, we are empowered by the power of the Holy Spirit to go do the things that John the Baptist did. The difference was his message was before the death and the resurrection and the ascension. Ours is after it. So therefore, now we are moving in power to reach the world. We too proclaim to the world in loving ways to repent. That's a good thing to teach. To change their hearts, their minds, and put themselves in a direction towards Jesus Christ and attune themselves to what the message has to say. We still need to proclaim to the world in loving ways, though. Sometimes we're a little harsh about it. Sometimes we get offended or get upset or we lose patience because we told people about Jesus Christ, but they didn't listen. In changing direction, we tell them to confess their sins. Now, that's a hard thing to do. Not only we're telling them to repent, but we're telling them to change their ways. We tell them to confess their sins and ask for forgiveness as they make Jesus Christ the center of their lives. And here's the one, wait for his return. You know, 500 people witnessed Jesus Christ die on the cross. Those 500 witnesses that saw him resurrected on the third day. And there was also 500 people that witnessed his ascension into heaven. 10 days after his ascension, only 120 were left. But we need to spread the gospel and for the people to understand and wait for his return. We can't speed it up. We can't do anything to make it come quicker. Jesus will come when God sends him, at his time, at his place. We read of his return in Acts 11. We also read it in Revelations 21. Repent, for the king has come and is coming again. Repent. That should be our slogan. Repent, for the king has come and is coming again. The king has come. He has died. He has paid the price. He has bought us. He has justified. We are now justified through what he did. And he is coming again. In this prophetic message, we have the world which we take. It's the world that we take to the world. It's our new world that we take to this fallen world. It is a world that's made whole by what Jesus Christ did on the cross. We need to practice a prophetic voice. We know when you got to put it in place, but we got to practice it. John the Baptist rebuked religious leaders all the time of his days, for they had bad orthodoxy and bad orthopraxy. We need to understand the difference between the two and put them in proper perspective. Don't miss the distinction between those two words. He proclaimed the prophetic message to the people, but he practiced a prophetic voice to the Pharisees and the Sadducees. You see, he didn't rebuke the people. He rebuked the Pharisees and Sadducees that should have known better. On one hand, he called people to repent, for the king was coming. On the other hand, he rebuked the people who should have known to repent because the king was coming. The church must learn to practice a prophetic voice that is anchored in the authority of the Word of God. It's got to be a voice that is not changed. I don't care what you think or you want. We need to understand that the authority of God's Word has not changed since it was written. And it means it's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. This word is so effective today as it was in the 1800s or the 3rd century. The church must learn. We must practice our voice. It doesn't work on a secular culture or on a people not claiming allegiance to Jesus Christ. When we practice our prophetic voice, it does not work on the secular culture because it goes against what they believe, or on people not claiming, because I tell people, the Bible says, I don't care what the Bible says. If those that don't believe it, they don't care. And they will tell you that. So we need to practice of what we're doing with our fellow believers to build us up so that we can say they can see a difference in us. However, many Christians want to practice a prophetic voice on non-believers in the realm of entertainment, sports and politics, and many other things. We want to do a prophetic voice in the realm of them. We want to change the church to look like them. Then what's the difference? If we're nothing more than a social club, what's the difference? Well, I'd rather join this other club because they give me what I want for entertainment. Or I might as well join the sports league. Sometimes we try to put a prophetic practice or voices in the areas that we are not called to do. Rather than calling out non-believers for behaving like non-believers, Christians should use a prophetic voice to those who share a common authority. If I tell you, and you tell me you're a believer, and I read out of the Word of God, and you tell me I don't care what the Word of God says, then you've got a problem. I'm sorry. You might want to go back to that cross and check on that salvation, because you cannot go against the Word of God and claim to be a Christian. You cannot claim authority as an ambassador and reject the one that sent you. A U.S. ambassador to Russia, he shows up there and he denies being an American. He denies being sent by the President of the United States. He is then no longer an ambassador of the United States. As Christians, we cannot go into this world and deny the Word of God and still claim to be His ambassador. Christians, followers, we need to practice a prophetic voice. This is a hard one. We need to also read the Word when it rebukes us. We need to also understand that as leaders, the Word of God is solid. And we cannot change the Word of God. We need to rebuke believers who have detoured from the gospel, theological, or practicality of the Word of God. Now, this is going to be a hard thing to say. And I'm not talking about different theologies. I'm not talking about different ways of worship. I'm talking about people that are preaching that this is not the Word of God. Practicing of how we worship God is not in Scripture. Some people practice dancing, screaming, yelling, jumping up and down. Others do it very quietly. That's a prerequisite that we have. Some of us like to come in dressed in a suit. Some of us like to wear blue jeans. That's your prerogative. That's not what I'm talking about here. I'm not talking about becoming judgmental. I'm talking about looking at what is being taught and preached and what are we doing as a church. We must perform a prophetic duty. John the Baptist had one duty. His one duty only, his, was to prepare the way of the Lord. He existed to make such of the coming of Jesus by preparing the hearts of the people to receive him when he came. Everything he did and all of who he was revolved around this sacred duty, preparing the way for Jesus Christ. That's what he did. Today, a prophetic duty can be summarized in quoting from Peter's first epistle, 1 Peter 2, verses 9 and 10. But you are a chosen race. Listen to this. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his possessions. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. You are a chosen race. We are a special separated race from the rest of the world. He's talking about how many races there are on the planet. He says five. I say there's two. There's the believers and the non-believers. That's it. What race do you belong to? Are you a royal? Are you royalty? The Bible says we are. We are a royal priesthood of a holy nation. That's why we're ambassadors. The church throughout history has demonstrated this prophetic duty living as people of God in a pagan world. The church throughout history has done this. They have demonstrated their duties by living as the people of God, not as the people of the nation, not the people of a country, but the people of God in a pagan world. Walter Winks noted, I'm quoting this out of Leslie Newberg Missionary Theologian magazine, the victory of the church over the Roman imperial system was not won by seizing the levers of power. It was won when the victims knelt down in the Colosseum and prayed in the name of Jesus for the emperor. Do you hear what he just said? The victory of the church over the Romans was not by getting people to become the emperor, but by praying in the Colosseum for the emperor. There's countless other examples of church performing her prophetic duty of living for the king. We read it throughout Scripture. We see it in the world today. We see people all over the world being massacred for their faith. When the church performs prophetic duty, it reflects the king in all of the realms of life. You see, we don't go in there. We show the reflection of it. So we should have a music that reflects the kingdom of God in our music. How many movies do we watch? How many movies do we watch that we disagree with politically or sensitivities, but yet we watch them anyway for entertainment? When the church performs prophetic duty, we must reflect the king in all realms of life, that she may become the most effective church in the world. Stephen Baldwin came to a church in North Carolina, and he spoke one day, and they asked him, says, why you as a Christian, why don't you change Hollywood? He told the church, he reached back in his wallet, pulled out his wallet, and he held his wallet up. He says, you want to change Hollywood? It's right here. It's in the power of your back pocket. You don't like those dirty movies? Don't pay to go see them. You don't like those violent movies? Don't go pay to go see them. Because Hollywood will only make movies that they make money on. And the reason they continue making those movies is because Christians continue to pay money to go watch those movies. Now, he said that, and I think it's true. You know why I know it's true? I'm guilty of that. I have done that. In light of being a prophetic witness, the church, we might want to rethink how we go about engaging in this culture, but how and what we do. You want to change the world? They need to see that we are different. I believe Jesus is more concerned with having a godly church with an outreach into the world than having a church live in a Christian nation. I'm going to say that again. Listen to what I'm saying. I believe Jesus is more concerned with having a godly church with an outreach into the world than having a church live in a Christian nation. Because we will live in the King, in the New Jerusalem. We're going to live in a holy nation one day. We're going to live in a place. So right now, I believe it's more important for the church to have an outreach into this culture than it is for us to think that we need a Christian nation. Now, I'm an American, and I was in the military for 20 years. I fought to defend the flag, and I love America. But what good is America if it becomes a Christian nation and we're not reaching out to nobody? Our missionaries are down. Our giving to missions are down around America. Now, I will tell you, I'm very proud of First Christian Church. I'm very proud of this congregation in Peru, Indiana, a little small church. They've reached out to South America. Last Sunday, I asked them,
We need to raise money so that we can give food to the churches in Pucallpa and San Diego in Peru, South America. And the church overwhelmingly gave, overwhelmingly touched. That's where I'm losing my patience now, not with the church, but how do I get the food now to the people? I've got the resources. I just don't know the how yet. So could you pray that God will give me the how so that we can, how can we get food to people that are starving? The government is not allowing food in. There are trucks in the mountain that are rotting with food because of this coronavirus. You see, this is the key. Our goal isn't to make our home here, but to reflect the coming home of the New Jerusalem. Our goal isn't to make our home here. Our goal is to reflect, and so that people can see the New Jerusalem in the church. They can see a church that is different than the world. What's the difference between us and another religion? That's the reason we cannot be a religion, but we got to be a church, a nation, a holy nation, different than the world, different than other religions. But we have to show the love of Christ in such a practical way. And in all honesty, we've actually seen the church in history have success living this way in pagan lands. The fastest growing church in the world is in China. Churches are growing underground in Iran, Jordan, Egypt, Afghanistan. The persecuted church is just making great strides because they are being different than the world. We have to be, and we have to show the success of living the way we live in a pagan land. We need to open up our hearts that the Lord will be able to use us to change the world. And First Christian Church, I've been here 6 years, and they're doing a great job, outreaches. We've done citywide crusades. We've reached out to South America. We planted 3 churches in South America. We've done so much stuff that the world doesn't even know about. But that's okay, because we are living that world. And I am not part of a club. I am not going to be part of an organization that wants to reflect how the Lions Clubs do things. Now, my dad was a member of the Lions Club. There's nothing wrong with the Lions Club or the Rotary Club. But those are social clubs. You join them because you like what they're doing. We didn't join the church because we like what the church is doing. We joined the church because of what Jesus Christ did on the cross. And then the church now does things so that people, that we become attractive to other people so that they can see a change in our lives. And we have accomplished that in many areas. But we cannot lose sight that we need to continue with our outreach, especially now after this COVID-19. The church has been absent in this. Now, we've had quiet prayers, we've had this, we've had a lot of things going on, but I'm talking about, where does the culture of this nation see us at? I've been told by pagans, don't tell me about the power of God because the church was hiding during the COVID-19. And I said, no, they weren't. They were just undercover. But we shouldn't have been. We don't need any secret agents, Christians. I don't need any Jane Bonds. I need some Rambos. We need to be out there fighting, showing the people who we are and what we are, not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How many churches today are empowered? It's not just numbers, people. Numbers can bring entertainment. I could bring, if Van Halen, I don't even know if Van Halen's still a band, but if I brought Van Halen up here on this stage, this place would be packed. I bring a family, Christian family, and we're having to spend all kinds of money to get people to come. I guarantee you that all I have to do is on Facebook say Van Halen First Christian Church Monday at 6 p.m. I would have to have cops in the doors keeping people away. Or any other pop artist that you want to call. Why? Because see, that's their culture. And we need to be a church of the culture of the Word of God. I call you, church, not just First Christian Church. I'm not talking just to you. I'm talking about the church of Jesus Christ, the church that was purchased on that old rugged cross. I'm talking about the church in all the nations around the world, that we should start shining our light and let our light shine, that the world may see that we are a nation, a holy priesthood, that we are the ones that were called by a living God, and that we need to proclaim that one day that King of Kings will return, and he's going to come and he's going to judge every one of us, and that that day of judgment is too late to repent, because you have now already at the judgment seat. But for you that have never accepted Jesus Christ, I'm going to make a prayer. I'm going to say a prayer. Repeat this, but repeat it in your hearts. And then find a good church. I don't care if it's in Peru, Indiana, or in Kalamazoo, Uruguay. I don't know where. Wherever you're living at. It's important, though, that you find a church and you find good Christian friends that can help you grow and become a mighty, mighty warrior for Christ. I hope you heard my message. I hope that your heart is moved. It is not a message of an attack or to make you feel guilty. It's a message that what we should be doing and what we can do and what we are going to do. This is great about our faith. If we haven't done it, God gives us another chance to do it. If we're doing it, then God strengthens us of what we are doing. But remember, we are ambassadors in a foreign nation. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord, for those that don't know you, Heavenly Father, I ask that they repeat this prayer. Heavenly Father, I'm a sinner. Heavenly Father, I have sinned against you. I have gone against the Word of God. Heavenly Father, I need the Holy Spirit in my heart. I need to be justified. I need to be forgiven. I need to be placed in your kingdom. Lord, I come to you as I am, needing help. Guide me, Lord, to a church, to a place that I can be discipled. Guide me to a place that I can read the Word of God and understand. Empower me by the power of the Holy Spirit that I may not return, and that the devil cannot come and steal these words from my heart. Seal it, Lord, in the blood of Jesus Christ. I thank you and I praise you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Well, I want to thank everyone for coming. I hope you got something out of the message. I hope you celebrated with your heart the singing. I hope you took communion with us. And I hope you do find a church if you don't belong to one. And if you do belong to one and the church hasn't been doing any outreach, well, it's time to speak up. Tell that elders and tell your deacons and your pastor, it's time to us to be the church that Jesus Christ birthed for us. First Christian Church has been going out for many times. We're going out again. We're looking for places to go where God leads us. If you want to join us, you're welcome to come. Thank you for listening. Thank you for attending. Thank you for coming. In the name of Jesus Christ, go in peace. May the peace of the Lord be with you and all of yours. Thank you.